Welcome to this episode of Eureka, and in this episode, we are going to discuss about some mysteries of the way the brain works and also at times fails. We have our guest, Dr. Srinivasa Chakravarthy. He is a professor of computational neuroscience at Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, Chennai. He is with the Bapur and Jyoti Mehta School of Biosciences in IIT Madras. Sir, thank you for being with us in this program. So let me start with, let's say, one very simple question that as a person who is working with in the area of neuroscience, I'm quite sure, for example, you would have handled quite a lot of brain, right? So do you work on live brain or brain harvested from, let's say, people who are dead?
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to clarify that this is a theoretical enterprise. So that's computational neuroscience is mainly theoretical and computational activity. Uh-huh. So we don't have to actually work with real brains. Uh-huh. We read up and study what people have found by observing and studying real brains. Uh-huh. And based on that data from published literature, we will build mathematical and computational models. Mm-hmm. Now, this might seem some bit strange to, in the biology domain. Although it's not in hardcore biology, it's not strange because computational biology and theoretical biology is a huge field.
Okay.
But thing is, if you look at physics, for example, right, you always study something both experimentally and theoretically.
Yeah.
Right. In the current days, you cannot imagine physics without equations.
Yeah. That's right.
Whereas in olden days, when people were studying, for example, astronomy, they're observing planetary motions and all that, they write these charts. You may not have any mathematical theory of why the planets are moving like that.
Okay.
All that theory came with practically Newton. Right? Newton created this revolution, Newtonian revolution, and showed how you can express all the complex motions of planets using a small set of equations.
Yeah.
Right? So until then, it was all observational. They were just had charts.
So basically descriptive. I observe and then I say that, this is like that, that is like that.
Yes.
Without necessarily going beyond appearances. Look at the essence, right?
Yeah, to look at the essence. Hmm. So you may not have any fundamental laws of planetary motion.
Okay.
The first step in that direction came with Kepler's laws. So where you could condense lots of patterns into a few, observational laws, just data patterns. Mm-hmm. And after that, Newton came and said, okay, there is a centralized gravitational field and, you have laws of mechanics.
Yeah.
Once it was done, it became a universal law of gravitation.
Yeah.
Until then, it was only our solar system, those five planets that we knew for a long time. But once Newton wrote the equation, it became universal. So that I keep saying that, that Newton revolution hasn't taken place yet in neuroscience.
Okay.
Because neuroscience is still quite observational. Mm-hmm. In fact, unfortunately, what is happening right now is because there's so many resources available, mm-hmm. you can do really fancy observations at microscopic level, single protein, single cell, and so on and so forth. Mm. So people are doing that more and more, creating mountains of data because we are living in the era of big data.
Okay.
Then it's fancy, it's very glamorous to create huge data.
Just a second before maybe coming to this big data emerging because of the new technology that we have. Maybe a few minutes of walk through the way, for example, we started understanding brain might perhaps help us in contextualizing your research. So, if you look at history of science, once upon a time that we thought, for example, emotions come from our heart.
Yeah.
That's why, we have this heart symbol wherever we are talking about emotion. Subsequently, we understood that it is from brain that things come. There were researchers like Broca and others who try to understand. Can you just tell us this, walk us through this history a little bit so that things happened earlier, how things changed when we had new tools, please.
Perfect. In fact, I have written a book called Demystifying the Brain.
Okay.
The very first chapter of this book is about history of neuroscience. The thing is, there is a strange dichotomy in here, history of neuroscience. For example, we knew about brain and anatomy and gross structure of the brain, ventricles, all that for thousands of years.
Okay.
Ancient Egyptians had some idea about brain. And even as late as 500 years ago, Leonardo da Vinci, the famous artist, he would also study brains and, work out the anatomy and all that.
Okay.
But when it comes to brain function, we didn't know much for a long time. Only in the late 18th century, we understood electricity. That is when we started to understand that brain is probably electrical matter, electrical tissue.
Okay.
That was the beginning. Mm. But even now, what is happening when it comes to brain function, there are lots of confusion, a lot of controversy. We don't fully understand brain function at large scale.
Mm.
Brain anatomy, name it and you have it.
Yeah.
Right? Different kinds of neurons, their shapes, all that is well understood, like beaten to death. But when it comes to function, there is a lot of confusion.
Mm-hmm.
So they even in understanding large-scale diseases like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, you know, there is a lot of vagueness. We don't fully understand what happens in this. There's a patchwork of data available.
Yeah.
From neuroimaging, from electrophysiology, and you know, from small organisms, model organisms, and so on. But we don't have a comprehensiveness, which is what we have in physics, for example.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, see, I come from electrical engineering.
Oh.
Right. You know, when you study electrical engineering, that's the basic circuits. You start with Kirchhoff's laws and what is a resistor, what is Ohm's law, what is Ampere's law. And then you work through the full superstructure, which is on this foundation. There is no such foundation in biology. It's all lots of details.
Yeah.
Right? And I find actually, it quite
even if you look at the history, go back in history, like for quite long time, I mean, because we did not have much instrument to actually study how the brain functions.
Yeah.
Basically, you have to wait till the people die. For example, if somebody... had a particular, let's say, a specific condition, like maybe you can speak, but your speech is not coherent.
Yeah, Broca's aphasia.
Yeah. So basically, you have to wait till that person dies and then see which part of the brain has a lesion.
Right.
And then maybe guess that perhaps that is what, you know, I mean, that's what we started, right?
Yes. Yes. So because of that, what happens is that the people try to work out some mapping between a brain region and a function, which is also not very realistic. It doesn't take you very far. It doesn't have much meaning if you really see, look deeply into it. So in the 80s, what happened is there is a new revolution called connectionism, which has come up, which basically says that it's all encoded in the connections of the brain.
Okay.
Just like in a large electrical circuit, signal goes from one module to next module, and there's filtering, there's amplification, there is, right, and so on. Like you have a cascade. In brain also, you have electrical signals going from region to region, spreading. Just like an electric circuit, only thing is it's a huge circuit with 100 billion units.
Yeah.
All right. But otherwise, it's very similar. There's some exchange of chemicals, right? So you can write it down using standard electrical circuit theory equations. It's not very mysterious. Only thing is it's so complex, so you have to figure out ways of simplifying it. I mean, that's where
this,
I think
this is a new instrument, like, say, for example, functional
MRI. Yeah.
Functional fMRI. How do you think that has changed the way, for example, we looked at the brain and the brain studies, how it has made, I mean, neuroscience basically, how it has made a major change?
Yes, it was a big revolution because now we can understand brain dynamics. So earlier with MRI, you can only have the brain structure, you know, if something goes wrong in structure, you can see. But with fMRI, and if you are thinking, if you are reading something, your visual area will be active. You know, if you are performing motor action, your motor areas will be active. So you can see that, you can even see interactions among areas. But I would say the real challenge is, even with fMRI, it's become another like another toy.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you can generate lots of data and keep on publishing. But why is the brain responding like that under those situations?
Okay.
Right? Do you have a theory? We don't. So because of that, I mean, there are theory. See, what happens is there are two kinds of theory.
Mm-hmm.
There are theory which are like curve fitting methods. You have some data, I need to fit a curve to this.
Okay.
And if you have fitted, I'm happy. Now, our astrology, you know, this Panchangam and all that, you know, ancient Indian traditional astrology, there is theory. I mean, you can actually fit trigonometric time series to planetary data. And they're pretty accurate. I mean, you know, when the Amavasya is, when the Purnami is, all that you can predict.
Yeah.
But I would say that's not real science.
Hmm.
It's a very empirical science.
Hmm.
It's a curve-fitting science. Whereas, if you understood it, once you crack Newton's laws, and more recently, general relativity, I mean, that's very profound theory with lots of connections and so on and so forth. That kind of a theory doesn't exist for brain as yet.
Okay.
A lot of people are saying it. You know, for example, the famous Indian neuroscientist, V.S. Ramachandran, who is based in San Diego, he keeps saying that, I mean, everywhere. And people don't like that because, you know, we are so enamored with our experimental tools. They're so fancy, very glitzy.
Mm-hmm.
But look under the hull. Where is the insight?
Mm-hmm.
You have mountains of data, but without much insight. So let us see, in India, we have a huge population of, you know, mathematicians,
mm-hmm.
computer scientists, programmers. Give them a little introduction to neuroscience. Don't overwhelm them with the biological jargon. Just say, just a fundamental introduction, right? And then induct them into neuroscience. I think in India, we can make a huge impact on neuroscience. If you look at neuroscience like this.
Okay.
If you do the traditional route, it is very long story. I mean, see, even the investments are just skyrocketing.
Oh.
Earlier, you know, $1 billion used to be huge money.
Oh.
Right, the huge brain products in Europe and US, but now $10 billion is also commonly you hear that number.
Uh-huh.
What's the point, right?
Okay.
India, we cannot afford to take that path. I mean, I strongly feel about it. I keep talking about it everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
We need to focus on building fundamental theory, and it doesn't cost much. We have the brains to do it. We just need a certain introduction, a certain orientation towards neuroscience in certain fashion, suitable for engineers and physicists and all these guys. But once you do that, you crack it. I mean, you can just, because what is happening now is with all the fancy stuff that's going on, right? There is not many applications coming out. There's not a single disease that we can say we can cure, right? It's only management, you know. And in fact, ironically, many cases where a drug works for a given disease, I don't know why it works.
Okay.
It's empirically, you know, it works through animal studies, clinical studies, and all that. I mean, I would like to understand the brain the way I understand a car motor, right? Or a ceiling fan. So thoroughly, there's no more doubt, right? If there's a problem, there's a problem. I should put my finger on it. That's when I say understanding.
Yeah.
We don't have that kind of understanding. We need to get there. It's possible. I have confidence that we can do it, provided we reorient ourselves in certain fashion.
Very, very interesting point. Maybe perhaps this is where we'll take a very short break. After the break, we'll continue this conversation. Keep watching, Eureka. After the break, we will continue this conversation. We will explore into the mysteries of brain. Welcome back to Eureka, and we are having a very interesting conversation with Dr. Srinivasa Chakravarti. He is a professor of computational neuroscience at Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, Chennai. You are an electrical engineer, but your lab is a computational neuroscience lab, and your work is basically on neuroscience. I mean, this doesn't seem to experience fit. It's like chalk and cheese. How does an electrical engineer come into studying brain?
Yeah, actually, it's a long journey. I mean, I did BTech in IIT Madras long ago. In 89, when I was just finishing, I came across about this emerging field of neural networks.
Okay.
Just coming up in the late 80s.
Uh-huh.
So somebody showed me a paper, and then when I went to US for higher studies, I found an assistantship with an Indian professor who was exactly working in that area.
Okay.
So I got into that, and I worked on that for my PhD.
Okay.
But at the end of PhD, I felt that this is still too much of engineering in this.
Uh-huh.
It's still quite dry. Probably brain is quite different,
uh-huh,
right, than what they're saying in this mathematical domain.
Okay.
So then for postdoc, I went to a medical school with somebody called Reed Montague, Professor Reed Montague.
Okay.
It was at Baylor College of Medicine.
Uh-huh.
He was a very inspiring researcher. I mean, he was like a brazier of ideas. You know, day in and day out, he's coming up with new ideas and discussing. And it was really, you know, very inspiring to work with him.
Mm-hmm.
And I also, that's when I got a taste of what real neuroscience is.
Mm-hmm.
He let me read the whole textbook of Kandel and Schwartz, like 1 month, you know, cover to cover.
Uh-huh.
I said, man, this is a field I'm going to work on all my life. Because there is logic in it. It's like in a computer science, there's logic, very logical, provided you look at it in a certain fashion.
Yeah.
Without getting lost in the details. So after coming back to India in 2000, I slowly got back to that and, you know, found my own path, kind of. Did a lot of stupid mistakes, tried very silly things, and found a different path. By about 2010, I could see that we have taken off in a new direction, even from mainstream people in that area. So we start working on Parkinson's and basal ganglia and all that.
Mm-hmm.
We took off in a new direction unknowingly,
mm-hmm,
right? And then it started giving very good results. See, what is happening right now in brain is, for any brain structure, you'll have a handful of theories floating around.
Okay.
There are different schools of thought, different camps.
So can you just give a glimpse of, let's say, maybe one or two important schools? What is that paradigm that people are looking at brain?
So let me give examples from basal ganglia.
Uh-huh.
So this is in the brain, you have on the surface, there's a sheet of neurons called the cortex. And then deep inside, you have masses of neurons. These are subcortical structures.
Okay.
Now, basal ganglia is one such subcortical circuit having a lot of modules.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a lot of people may not have even heard of this, but there's one tiny part of this which gets damaged.
Mm.
In Parkinson's, and because of that, you see problems in pretty much everything that brain does.
Okay.
Like motor, sensory motor, cognitive, affective, autonomic, everything can be affected because of loss of this tiny part.
Okay, all for want of a nail, kind of.
All for want of a nail, literally, yes. It's a very small region, yes.
Uh-huh.
But very crucial because it sends projections to everywhere in the brain, and so it's very important that way.
Uh-huh.
Now, when people study this, since this system has so many different functions, you know, it manifestations in many different domains, it's only natural that people study one thing at a time.
Okay.
You only study its, you know, effect on hand movements, or only speech, you know, only, and so on and so forth. So there's no integration of all this. How come the same structure is showing up in so many different domains? Right? What is the common factor, you know, common mechanism? So if you in computations domain, in a language, if you say backend and frontend, the backend system is the same. Its frontend is changing. Same thing is showing up in eye movements, in speech, you know, in your high handwriting and walking and so on and so forth. The backend gate system is the same. So we need to understand it like that. We need to work out the math like that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so there was a book published by MIT Press in the 90s saying information processing models of the basal ganglia. So all the big names in the field have contributed. Like I said, when I said schools of thought, different people focus on different aspects and, you know, give a commentary from that direction.
Okay.
Which is totally valid.
Something like, for example, five blind men and the elephant.
Like, so, exactly. That's a perfect analogy. Yeah. Or even quantum mechanics, you have this, you know, wave mechanics versus matrix mechanics, right?
Yeah.
And both are different ways of doing the same thing about how do you integrate them.
Yeah.
So like that, there are different views and, you know, there is no integration. So we worked on that. I feel that very strongly that it's bad. This, you cannot go on like this. So we did a very humble study on those directions, trying to integrate. And we could do with most motor functions of basal ganglia into a single model. And that's what we published in 2018.
Okay.
It was a Springer published book called Computational Neuroscience Models of the Basal Ganglia.
Okay.
So after that, our group became more confident in the sense that we feel that now we can do this for other systems in the brain. So about 5-6 years ago, we started work on another brain system called hippocampus.
Okay.
Hippocampus is very important because of its functions in spatial navigation. So, you know, mice can run mazes and, you know, they're very good at that.
Yeah.
So that capability is coming because of hippocampus.
Oh.
And this aspect of hippocampus has become very popular and glamorous because of the Nobel Prize, which was given in 2014.
Yeah, I mean, people also kind of named it as GPS of the brain.
GPS of the brain and all that, yeah. So Edward Moser and Maybrit Moser in Norway and John O'Keefe in US, they were given this prize. So we started working on this, and there also we were able to create a kind of a unified model, which can explain a wide variety of, these are called spatial cells. Cells which encode space, they are located in hippocampus. So we could develop a comprehensive model. One of these papers was published in Nature Communications a few years ago. So now there also we feel we are confident enough to come up with an integral model and publish a book, put everything together and publish a book. Now with this, now I keep talking about this here and there and saying that, you know, we need a center which can specialize in this approach, you know, simplified brain models.
Okay.
Simplified but unitary, comprehensive, integrative, right? Not one thing at a time, you know, in isolation. And then once we can work out that kind of a brain model, let's say in 10, 15 years, I mean, imagine the kind of impact it will have on clinical practice. Because right now, clinical neurology is very empirical.
Oh.
I mean, typically, that's how the field is, right? You know, it's like brain is like a black box. This is a disease, and these are the symptoms, and these are the treatments. Like a lookup table. It's a very complex lookup table, but that's what the doctor, you know, kinds of masters, right? But point is, if you know it like in science, like in engineering, this is the engine. When things go wrong, these are the patterns of breakdown.
Okay.
If this pattern, we'll call it schizophrenia. This pattern, we call it dementia. This pattern, right? That you can master it like that only if you have a sufficiently simple model. So there are people who are trying to literally simulate neuron by neuron, all 100 billion neurons. I mean, that's very expensive. That's, you know, I feel it's a bit of brute force. It's very hard to do that. I mean, let me give another example. Let's say you are studying fluid mechanics.
Yeah.
You want to study airflow over an aircraft wing.
Oh.
If you simulate at single molecule level, it will take a century to
do
the simulation. It's very hard. I mean, it's why do you want to do that? Whereas, you just use fluid flow equations, Navier-Stokes equations. Very simple. Even that is quite complex, but I mean, you have a handle on the problem. We need to do the same thing about brain. Brain is no different. It follows some very simple laws. In fact, ultimately, what we should do, we should rewrite neuroscience like this. If I write a textbook on neuroscience, the first few chapters will be the fundamental laws of the brain. Let us say there are some 10 laws. I describe them, define them, you know, mathematically characterize them. Subsequent chapters, I apply them everywhere and explain how things work. Very simple, logical. It's like open book. Brain becomes an open book. I mean, why can't we work out things like that? Why?
So that is the main direction in which your lab, you are trying to let's go to another interesting area of research that your lab is in the news today. That's about Parkinson's disease. So can you tell us that what was this research and what have you found out of this?
Thank you. So thing is, for about until about 2015, we have been building models of basal ganglia, where we assume that there is loss of cells in SNC. We don't know why. Now, what are the consequences of that? Why are you seeing this symptom? This is what we've been doing. But starting with 2015, I got a very brilliant, inspired student called Vignan. For his PhD thesis, we started looking at this problem. That is, why are these cells dying in the first place?
Okay.
Until now, we said we somehow we have taken it as a given data. They're dying. We don't know why. In fact, it's called idiopathic. We don't know why. Right? So then there was, people have already proposed that maybe there is, it's because of a metabolic deficiency. There are some ideas on those lines, proposals, and there's also some experimental evidence. But there is no comprehensive theory. Is it really like that? So we said, let us test that using by developing detailed models.
Okay.
So Vignan developed a series of models at multiple levels, multiple scales, starting at network level, like a large scale model of basal ganglia. Then models of this substantia nigra cells.
Okay.
Then intracellular process, all the chemistry that happens inside the cell. Like a single cell has about 170 equations. Single cell model. So then we he found that if you squeeze energy feed into the cells, all the pathologies that you observe, alpha-synuclein aggregation, calcium elevation, you know, Lewy body formation, ROS production, all of them come as effects.
Okay.
So very often there is a confusion of what is the cause, what is the effect, because all this, the loss of this cause and effect loops in the brain.
It's
very confusing, which is a cause, which is an effect. But it's now it's no more confusing. It's clear. Right? You squeeze the energy feed, glucose and oxygen, and then all these are, you know, side effects of that. So there seems to be, basically what's happened, this whole circuit seems to go into some kind of a runaway effect, where if the degradation happens beyond a threshold, loss will happen beyond the threshold. It's like just whole thing just tumbles down. Okay,
it's like the sand pile. I mean, as long as the sand pile is
critical mass.
I mean, it stands. I mean, more sand, then it just crumbles.
That's it.
Yeah.
It seems to hit such a point. The brain, basal ganglia, seems to hit such a point. After that, you know, there is no looking back.
Okay.
So now, can you intervene in these positive feedback cycles and arrest that degradation?
Okay.
But so in fact, we have this is not a, we haven't worked out the complete story, because the next story, which we were just discussing with Vignan a few days ago, is why is there energy shortage for these guys? First of all, these cells are under very huge metabolic stress.
Yeah.
Because they're very busy cells, you know, they are hugely connected and have very high metabolic demands.
Yeah.
But I mean, why isn't the vascular system, which is what delivers energy everywhere in the brain, why is it failing for these cells?
Okay.
I mean, not only these cells, other clusters of neurons, which are what are called the diffuse projection systems. These are the neurons which release important chemicals like, you know, dopamine, serotonin, norepinephrine, acetylcholine. In fact, even in PD, it's not just dopamine. Other neuromotor systems also can be affected, but generally people talk about only dopamine.
Okay.
Others also are affected, right? These are very vulnerable because a small number of cells talking to lots of people. I mean, they're punching way above their height in a sense, right? So I mean, it's very likely. You need to expect that to happen, you know, sooner or later, right? Now, how do you intervene and then make sure the efficiency of delivery of energy for these cells is slightly higher? So we need to then model the neurons and vascular system, the neurovascular coupling, you know, in a lot more detail. So I have another student working on this neurovascular coupling, but we need to do a lot more work before we get to this point.
Okay, okay. So what you are pointing out is that by doing this computational neuroscience, not only you are able to find what is the cause, what is the effect, but also how we can perhaps intervene when things are becoming challenging. How to relook and maybe do a right kind of intervention so that the deterioration is arrested. That's the hope that we have. It's a very, very interesting discussion, conversation that we had. One of the very interesting aspects that has come out is Parkinson. Given the fact that a country like India, the average life expectancy is increasing, a lot more people would be predisposed to such a situation. So maybe 50 years ago, 100 years ago, this is not a big problem because life expectancy was low. But with the improved living condition, I think it's an important challenge to look at. For example, when India got freedom, we looked at the infant mortality as an important challenge. I think today we need to also look at the age to problem, right? I mean, that's what I also get from your... So we don't have much time, but last, what do you want to share to our viewers in this episode?
So I would like to popularize neuroscience in a big way in India. Like, you know, not only me, but, you know, create a network of colleagues within India and let just talk to school students, for example, or engineering students, present ideas about by in a very simple way and kind of remove the fear, you know, inhibitions and barriers, you know, hang-ups about brain, and then get them excited about it, bring them. I think if we can kind of energize people and let them get them interested in neuroscience, we can make a huge impact.
That's I think, fun. A very important point to end this episode for want of time. Even if you are not engaged in biology, even if your area is engineering and computer science, there is a big role for people in neuroscience. That's one important takeaway message, I think, that comes from here. Because people usually think that if you have not studied biology in your plus two, I mean, that area is completely out of view. That is not the situation.
No. In fact, I mean, pretty much every engineer can contribute to neuroscience, chemical, mechanical, electrical, even management, in decision making and all the materials. I mean, everybody is welcome. So it's such an interesting field.
That's the, I think, one important key takeaway for young people who are in school, college, and various educational places. Thank you for being with us in this.
Thank you very much.
It was a very, very wonderful conversation. Keep watching, Eureka. We'll come back with another interesting episode next week. Same
thing. Thank you.